Now, I want to deal with John Berman, CNN's John Berman. He said this.
So we've seen it twice in recent weeks. Republican lawmakers defending the infamous three-fifths compromise, which declared that slaves be counted as three-fifths of a person. The latest instance just yesterday on the floor of the Tennessee State House, where a Republican representative claimed the deal was about ending slavery. CNN's Laura Jarrett, co-anchor of Early Start, joins us now with more. I can't believe this.
I can't believe this. Berman. During the break, I'm going to look up and find out what this man studied when he was in college. Assuming he went to college. I'm assuming he did. The third grade Cliff Notes version of the three-fifths compromise is that it's a demonstration of how racist America was, when in fact it was a compromise reached between the North and the South. The South did not want three-fifths. They wanted 100%. They weren't going to give blacks the right to vote, of course, but for purposes of political power and apportionment, representation in Congress, they wanted them to be called 100%. So it weakened Southern power. It didn't strengthen it. Here is Carol Swain, who's in the movie Uncle Tom, by the way, which is available now on YouTube and on iTunes and on Amazon Prime and on UncleTom.com. Carol Swain is in the film. She did a PragerU on why the three-fifths compromise, quote, was anti-slavery.
One of the most misunderstood clauses in the United States Constitution is found in Article 1, Section 2. Representatives shall be apportioned among the states by adding to the whole number of free persons, three-fifths of all other persons. Known as the three-fifths compromise, it raises an obvious question. How could the founding fathers, who endorsed the idea that all men are created equal, also endorse the idea that some men aren't? In 2013, James Wagner, president of Emory University, answered the question this way. The three-fifths compromise was an example of difficult but necessary political bargaining. Without it, Wagner argued, the northern and southern states would never have agreed to form a single union. No three-fifths compromise, no United States of America. Many people, including 31 members of his own faculty, vehemently disagreed. Wagner, the faculty member suggested, was excusing the inexcusable. They signed an open letter stating that the three-fifths compromise was an insult to the descendants of slaves and an example of racial denigration. So who's right? Let's look at the text again. Representatives shall be apportioned among the states by adding to the whole number of free persons, three-fifths of all other persons. Note that the Constitution does not say that a slave is not a person. It explicitly says that they are persons. And it also does not say that a slave is three-fifths of a person, as many today mistakenly believe. The three-fifths description had nothing to do with the human worth of an individual slave, but everything to do with how many representatives each state would have in the U.S. Congress. For that purpose, states could only claim three-fifths of their slave population. The three-fifths compromise was devised by those who opposed slavery, not by those who were for slavery. Or to put it another way, it wasn't the racists of the South who wanted to count slave populations less than white populations. It was the abolitionists of the North. The framers of the Constitution were deeply divided on the issue of slavery. The free states of the North wanted to abolish it. The slave states of the South wanted to expand it. You might say that the Southern slave states wanted to have it both ways. They wanted to count their slaves for the purpose of representation, but they didn't want to give any representation to their slaves. Why did this matter? Let's look at the numbers. In the 1790 census, just 3 years after the Constitution was ratified, the free states of New Hampshire, Massachusetts, Rhode Island, Connecticut, New York, New Jersey, Pennsylvania, and Delaware had a population of about 1.8 million free whites. The slave states of Maryland, Virginia, North Carolina, South Carolina, and Georgia had about 1.1 million free whites and 633,000 slaves. Add those two numbers and you get nearly equal populations between the North and the South. By the time of the Civil War, the slave population had grown to 4 million. Imagine how much more powerful slave states would have been without the Three-Fifths Compromise. If 100% of the slave population had been counted, slavery may very well have lasted into the 20th century.
We're going to have more of Carol Swain's explanation of the Three-Fifths Compromise. Maybe John Berman will learn something. 888-971-SAGE. CNN, most trusted name in news.